Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Stolen Childhoods, Thriving After Abuse by Shari Botwin, Lcsw, narrated by Shari Botwin, Lcsw. This book is for you, buddy boy. It was not until I became your mama that I realized I am so much more than a childhood abuse survivor. Parenting and loving you has proven to me that we can break the cycle of abuse. You are a beam of light, joy, and happiness. Introduction. For over 25 years, I stayed silent about my history of childhood abuse. In fact, for most of my childhood and early adulthood, I had no conscious memory that anything had happened to me. I always knew something was wrong in my family, but I had no words or ways to describe my feelings. I started working in the psychology field immediately after I received my master's in social work. Months later, I started working as a group therapist in a renowned center for eating disorders, Renfrew Center. Most of the residents checked into this facility because they had a raging eating disorder that was ruining their physical and emotional well-being. Every day I ran these groups, residents were talking about their history of surviving some type of childhood abuse. One young woman in her early 20s told the group that the only way she was going to be able to recover and let go of her eating disorder was if she began dealing with the sexual abuse by her swimming coach as a child. Another resident in her late 50s shared that she lost decades of her life in adulthood after burying years of physical abuse done to her by her father. After working at Renfrew for a couple of months, I noticed a shift in my personality. I became withdrawn. I had panic attacks when I left work for the day. I sat in my apartment and just stared at the walls at the end of each day. I started avoiding contact with my family. While I did not speak a word about my abuse, I was able to tell my supervisor that I felt depressed and overwhelmed. I told her that I had also struggled with eating disorder behaviors starting around the age of 13. I was able to identify that the biggest trigger for me working at Renfrew was hearing about residents who had been abused as children. My supervisor asked me if I had a history of trauma or abuse as a child, and I adamantly denied such a thing. I told her I could not relate to these residents and that I felt incapable of helping them. She suggested that I go to therapy. At the time, I was mad and defensive, but there was a part of me that felt relieved that someone finally recognized that I was in pain. For about the next 6 months, I kept repeating this mantra in my head as I drove to work. I kept repeating to myself, I need help. I need to tell someone. At the time, I was not conscious of what I needed to say. I knew I was falling apart and that I had to do something. After much hesitation and reluctance, I decided to go to therapy. I met my therapist, Dorothy, when I was 26 years old. When she asked me what my relationship was like with my family, I told her, "Oh, we are very close. My mom is like my best friend." As I spoke these words, I could feel wrenching pain in my gut. I never told Dorothy what I was feeling in my body. I only talked about the thoughts going on in my head, which usually were conflicted and fragmented. Months after I lost a close family friend to cancer, my depression worsened. I thought about how this world would be better off without me in it. I felt like my heart was racing and my body was frozen when I spent time with my parents. One day, when I went to my parents' house to grab some items for my apartment, I lost it. I ran out of the house, got in my car, and sobbed. It made no sense to me. I had no idea what was happening or where these feelings were coming from. I called Dorothy and told her I needed help. When she called me back and asked me what I needed help with, I could not answer her. I was so confused. I felt like my world was turning upside down. I had no words, but I noticed that my body was feeling all kinds of sensations. At the time, I could not speak in words about what my body was trying to tell me. Days after that episode at my parents' house, I picked up the phone and I left Dorothy another voicemail saying, "I was sexually abused as a child. Someone went inside of me." When I met with Dorothy for our next session after I left that voicemail, she sat in her chair with tears pouring down her cheeks. I was frozen. I could not feel my body in the chair, and I dissociated my way through that session. I could see that she was concerned about me, but I could not take in the empathy she was expressing. I felt guilty, and I felt like I was betraying my parents. I was not able to tell myself or Dorothy who abused me, or how old I was when it started and ended. Once I broke my silence, my body would not let me forget that I had been sexually abused. Every time I shamed or belittled myself for speaking about the abuse, I had body memories, which is a form of dissociation. I continued seeing Dorothy, but I spent most of my sessions trying to pick a fight with Dorothy to avoid dealing with my grief and heartbreak. I would do anything to make the truth not so. I spent hours each day agonizing as my body felt different sensations from the assaults. I had flashes of my younger self at all different ages. I had memories of being on the playground in grade school, feeling disconnected and ashamed. I remembered thinking at different ages, "Someone is hurting me at night." I had flashbacks of being in middle school and wishing that the principal would tell me that my parents had died and that I needed to go live somewhere else. I had vivid memories of being a teenager and looking at myself in the mirror in horror. At the time, I saw a young woman that was full of shame and despair. As the memories came flooding back, I began to put pieces of my fragmented life together. I started seeing Dorothy 3 to 4 times a week so I could continue processing memories and find ways to keep myself safe. I did not want to go inpatient because I had a dog that I loved to pieces and I wanted to continue working so I could be financially independent. I stayed in intensive outpatient therapy for years. I carried around a small notebook that I could write in so that when the memories, thoughts, or feelings came to the surface, I could write them down. It took me weeks at a time to find words and tell Dorothy each time I had a new memory or flashback. I went into depressive episodes, and on many occasions, I called Dorothy and told her I did not want to be alive anymore. There were dozens of sessions when I told Dorothy I wished I had never opened my big fat mouth. I felt like a horrible daughter. I felt like a total misfit. I felt ruined. I continued to go to therapy, but I used every defense mechanism I could to try and forget what I had already remembered. I repeatedly said to myself, "I am a liar," and denied that anything happened to me. At the time, I convinced myself that Dorothy did not believe me. When I left the therapy sessions, I wanted to disappear. I thought of different ways I could end my life. I stopped eating and my sleep patterns were a mess. I had nightmares, flashbacks, and body memories. For several months, I would not tell Dorothy who hurt me. I denied that any of the abuse was done to me by my parents. At one point, I told her that I was sexually and physically abused by babysitters who stayed at my house for a week while my parents went on vacation. After spending over 6 months trying to convince myself I was abused by babysitters, I told the truth. Dorothy and I spent years trying to help me accept what happened to me and the impact my childhood abuse had on my ability to connect with others. We spent hours in session trying to help me develop coping strategies as my fragmented, horrific childhood began making more sense. We worked on helping me speak about my past without reliving the traumas. We talked at length about what I was feeling in my body and what my body was trying to tell me about what I was feeling. I learned how to replace shame and rage with self-love and self-compassion. I spent years grieving for all that was lost during my childhood. Gradually, I began to accept my truth and let go of my defenses. Once I was able to acknowledge that my dad abused me, I was able to think more about my present and my future. I was able to own that I wanted to be more than a therapist and a patient. I began feeling worthy and deserving of having a support system the size of an army. I could imagine myself in an intimate relationship and having children. As I integrated years of childhood abuse memories, I noticed a shift in my private practice. I began working much more with clients who had horrific abuse histories. I began counseling more men and women who broke their silence decades after they experienced being physically, emotionally, or sexually abused and neglected in their childhoods. I began learning more about different therapeutic strategies that I could use to help support clients in their healing. I would use various parts of my healing experience to try and help clients move through the speaking and recovering process with less pain and less loss. When I think back to that day when I told Dorothy what was done to me as a child and the years to follow, I think about all the men and women who are suffering in silence. I think about all the years I went to therapy 3 to 4 times a week just to keep myself safe and moving forward. When I broke my silence in 1999, topics like childhood abuse and sexual assault were hardly spoken about. Survivors were being disbelieved, and resources for victims were limited. Once the hashtag MeToo movement came to life, many more men and women were speaking up about being sexually assaulted by men in powerful positions. However, there still was very little attention given to the millions of men and women who were abused as children by their parents, coaches, doctors, teachers, and others in positions of authority. Months after Judge Rosemary Aquilina sentenced former Olympic doctor Larry Nassar to 40 to 175 years for abusing at least 160 gymnasts and athletes, I connected with her and many of Nassar's victims. Finally, the world was being shown that these types of crimes against children have devastating effects. For 7 days, I watched dozens of Nassar's victims confront him in court. Many women stood before him, giving them their victim impact statement. Ali Raisman looked Nassar in the eye, saying, "The effects of your actions are far-reaching. Abuse goes way beyond the moment, often haunting survivors for the rest of their lives, making it difficult to trust and impacting their relationships." When I listened to Raisman and other gymnasts talk about the impact of abuse, I decided I need to write this book. I knew the effects of childhood abuse had a tremendous impact on our ability to trust ourselves and others. I knew that the years of undigested feelings and memories were wreaking havoc on our functioning on many levels. I had experienced and witnessed dozens of clients who were barely keeping themselves alive as they began to speak up about what was done to them by their parents or other family members or trusted authority figures. On many occasions, I was told, "Just get over it," or, "Why can't you just leave that in the past?" when I tried to get support during my recovery. I had spoken to several clients who were also invalidated and banished from their families for telling the truth. Most of the clients I have worked with in my private practice did not tell me about what happened to them until we had been in therapy for at least 2 years. In fact, most of my clients did not know that what was done to them was abuse until they became parents themselves or had been adults for years and understood what happened to them. For example, I have counseled dozens of people who are emotionally and physically abused by family members or others close to their families. Most of the clients who sought out treatment with me did not start dealing with their childhood traumas until they were in their 30s, 40s, and even 60s. I met one male client who just started talking about the abandonment by his father and emotional neglect by his mother after battling with major depressive disorder until his late 60s. I met another female client who did not realize that growing up in a family filled with domestic violence was what kept her stuck in an abusive marriage for over 25 years. I wanted to write this book for all the people in this world who have gone unnoticed and who struggle with demons and traumas from their childhood. I want you to feel differently about your healing process when you finish this book. I want you to understand the impact of your experience. I want you to be able to identify a host of strategies that you can implement in your healing. I want you to understand the impact of your abuse has had on you and how you can flip horror, shame, and grief into hope, victory, and peace. I want you to be able to share your thoughts with loved ones or people that support you so they can be better equipped to give you what you need. I want you to find your voice and figure out how you can use your pain to change your life moving forward. I want you to be able to sit in your body without feeling shame and rage. I wanted to write this book so I could offer insights I did not have early in my healing and to serve as a guide for you in your journey. I wanted to incorporate all the lessons I have learned as a patient and a therapist. I want you to feel less alone and know that whatever you are feeling is normal after surviving something that is not normal. I want you to be able to honor and heal your body. I want you to be able to sit in your body and to trust your gut. I want you to understand the pathology of your perpetrators or dysfunctional family system, and I want you to stop blaming yourselves for the choices others made when you were a child. If it works for you, grab a notebook or a journal and write down statements or questions you want to continue exploring in your healing. Think about what you want in your life moving forward and know that anything is possible if you believe it can be so. It is important to move ahead with caution and give yourself the time and space you need to process and digest what you hear in the chapters ahead. Take breaks. Talk to others. Reach out to your therapist. Journal your thoughts and feelings. One of the biggest lessons I have learned in this crazy-making process as a survivor and therapist is that we need to learn how to set boundaries and replace self-destruction with self-care. We need to check in with ourselves, identify what we are feeling, and make appropriate choices at the time. We need to be able to place our feelings when we are triggered and have a host of coping strategies when the flashbacks, nightmares, or feelings take hold of our minds and bodies. We need to recognize that we cannot cure our PTSD. We cannot make our past disappear. We can learn how to live with and accept our truth. We need to find ways to stop our childhood abuse from coming into our present. We need to figure out how to train our minds to stay in the moment versus live like we are in a constant state of danger. And we can do that with tons of support and self-care. We have choices. We are not just survivors of childhood abuse. We are parents, partners, and friends. And there are people in this world that need us to be okay. I hope by the end of this book, you feel empowered, validated, heard, and understood. I hope you learn how to love and nurture your younger self, and that any remnants of shame or despair fade back into your past. Note to listeners, all identities have been changed and disguised to protect my client's privacy. Chapter 1. Forms of Childhood Abuse. Approximately 1 in 4 children experience some type of child abuse or neglect in their lifetime. According to the CDC, 750 children died in 2020 from abuse or neglect. Government officials warn these numbers are likely an underestimate because many cases go unreported. According to the National Library of Medicine, 1 out of 3 girls and 1 out of 5 boys will be sexually abused before they reach age 18. 90% of child sexual abuse victims are abused by a family member or someone they know. Rates of child abuse are 5 times higher for children and families with low socioeconomic status. Over 3 million cases of child abuse and neglect are reported every year. Child abuse and neglect are serious public health problems that need much more attention. Neglect is the most common form of child abuse that is reported. These cases make up more than 60% of abuse cases. Children experience these types of abuse by parents, caregivers, teachers, coaches, doctors, and religious leaders. Physical abuse. Physical abuse occurs when a child is purposefully physically injured or put at risk of harm by another person. Examples include hitting, kicking, shaking, burning, or other forms of force against a child. When parents choose to use physical punishment as a form of discipline, that is still considered physical abuse. Signs to look out for are unexplained bruises, broken bones, or fractures or burns. Children often don't have an explanation that matches the harm inflicted when an adult asks them why and where those injuries occur. In most cases, children feel guilty, ashamed, and confused, and they are afraid to tell anyone about the abuse. There usually are red flags when a child is being harmed physically. These warning signs include withdrawal or isolation from their friends, changes in behavior, changes in school performance, depression, anxiety, panic, loss of self-confidence, sleep disruption, nightmares, and frequent absences from school or extracurricular sports. Teenagers who are being abused may exude rebellious or defiant behavior, self-harm, and even suicide attempts. Risk factors in younger children include colicky babies, toilet training accidents, poverty, and addiction or untreated mental health problems with one or both parents and caregivers. Other factors that put children at higher risk are when parents are engaged in criminal activity or there is domestic violence between adults living in the home. Large family size or parents who act like having children is a problem are also indicative in many cases of child physical abuse. Keep in mind, there are children who are physically abused who do not have high risk factors in their home environment. No child is immune from having harm inflicted upon them by a trusted adult or authority figure. Sexual abuse. Child sexual abuse is any sexual activity with a minor under 18 years old. Different types of sexual contact, such as sexual touching, oral genital contact, or intercourse, are forms of abuse. Child sexual abuse can also involve non-contact activities, such as forcing children to watch pornography or witnessing an adult acting out sexually. Other forms are sexual harassment, prostitution, and sex trafficking. Warning signs that a child may be a victim are pregnancy, sexually transmitted infections, genital or anal pain, bleeding, or inappropriate sexual behavior with other children. Child sexual abuse does not discriminate. However, there are factors that can make some children more susceptible to this type of abuse. Children between the ages of 7 and 13 are at highest risk. Children who live in homes with one parent or a parent and his or her partner increase the likelihood of sexual abuse. Females are 5 times more likely to be abused. 20% of these children are abused by the age of 8. The risk is 3 times higher for children whose parents are not working. Predators tend to look for children who are passive, quiet, troubled, lonely, insecure, or overly trusting. There are several indicators that a child is being sexually abused. Some behaviors to keep an eye out for are excessive talking about sexual topics, talking very little to others, not wanting to be left alone with certain caretakers, or being afraid of separating from primary caregivers. Other behaviors that are indicative of child sexual abuse are bedwetting, thumb-sucking, being overly compliant, spending excessive amounts of time alone, and trying to avoid bathing or changing clothes. Emotional signs that a child is being sexually abused are a change in eating patterns, change in mood or personality, decrease in self-confidence, excessive fear, unexplained somatic complaints such as stomach aches and headaches, a loss of interest in spending time with peers, and self-harming behaviors. The most important thing to keep in mind when there is suspicion of abuse are sudden changes in a child's behavior. If you sense in your gut something is wrong, do not avoid these feelings. Talk to other trusting adults and consider making a report to the local police or child welfare department. It is better to be wrong than turn your back on a child who may be in danger emotionally or physically. Adults may exude signs that are engaging in inappropriate sexual behavior with a child. Some things to watch for are adults who do not respect boundaries or listen when someone tells them no. If an adult is engaging in conversations that are not age-appropriate, or if he or she is talking about his or her personal problems with a child, that is a warning sign of potential perpetrator behavior. If an adult is giving a child gifts without a reason or spending abundant amounts of time with a child, that indicates that the relationship is not within the adult-child boundaries. Emotional abuse. Emotional abuse refers to behaviors that harm a child's self-esteem or well-being. Examples include name-calling, withholding love, shaming, rejecting, or threatening harm. Risk factors include social isolation, separation from extended family, adults with a physical or mental illness, such as post-traumatic stress disorder, eating disorders, depression, alcohol or drug dependency, financial stress, and poverty. Indicators that children exhibit when they are being emotionally abused are a lack of confidence, inability to manage their emotions, and difficulty making connections. Adults who act out emotionally onto children tend to be very judgmental, ignore boundaries, are controlling, manipulative, and dismissive of other people's feelings. Narcissistic parental abuse is a common form of emotional abuse that is misunderstood and dismissed by many. Parents who act out in this way have an excessive need for admiration or attention at the expense of their children's well-being or regard. Some of these adults may have narcissistic personality disorder, but that is not always the case. Some adults only act in these ways towards children. In a recent article published in Psychology Today, Dr. Ilm Lowe describes 3 types of parental narcissistic abuse. The first type is when parents use their children to fill their own ego. They take praise and accomplishments of their children and make it about themselves. If these children lose a game or suffer some type of setback, these adults may withdraw their love and approval. Children coming from this type of family environment often describe feeling like they are treated as a trophy versus a person. In this type of narcissistic abuse, it is common for parents to make one child the perfect one and make other children in the family the scapegoat. This type of abuse leaves the perfect child feeling guilty and the other siblings feeling like they are being banished. Vulnerable narcissists are insecure and emotionally unstable. This type of abuse involves guilt trips and control. It is difficult for others to recognize because these adults often appear insecure and passive in ways others cannot see. These parents lack self-esteem and may feel isolated from other connections. They resort to control to try and get their children to be emotionally dependent upon them, to serve as an ego booster, and to improve their self-worth. Often children in these families report feeling like the peacemaker or caregiver, and sometimes they refer to themselves as the family therapist. The third type of narcissistic parent cannot deal with feeling overshadowed by their children. They often react with anger and jealousy when their children appear to be more successful than they are. These types of parents often attack their children or give them the silent treatment when they feel inferior or outdone by their children's successes. Children living in these types of dysfunctions often describe feeling like they are walking on eggshells. I have met several clients who describe their parents as Jekyll and Hyde, saying, "One minute my mom loves me, and then like a switch comes on, and she hates me, even though I have not done anything." Over time, children growing up in these types of households will learn to keep any good news or accomplishments a secret in order to protect themselves from feeling shot down or belittled. The jealousy and competitive environment will also leave other members of the household feeling guilty for being happy or for having any type of success. In some cases, these children will self-sabotage to avoid feeling guilty. Neglect. Neglect is the failure to meet a child's needs physically and emotionally. This may include housing, food, clothing, or access to education or medical care. Children being neglected often have poor hygiene, are inappropriately dressed for weather, have unmet medical and dental care, are unsupervised at home, and experience failure to thrive and malnutrition. Some children who are neglected will beg for food or steal, miss school, or show up unannounced at other people's homes. Some of the emotional signs that a child is being neglected are excessive willingness to please, parentified and acting like adults, on edge most of the time, or has learning issues but no specific educational deficit. These children may act out at school, have very low self-esteem, or be emotionally detached. Over 59% of all reported cases of child abuse constitute neglect. Long-term effects of childhood abuse. The effects of long-term childhood abuse can be devastating and life-altering years into one's adulthood. There are physical, psychological, and behavioral problems adult survivors grapple with. Even years or decades after the mistreatment ends, survivors may find themselves dealing with mental disorders, somatic issues, and other health problems. The impact often runs throughout a family system for multiple generations, which causes some survivors to repeat the abuse done to them onto their spouses or children. Some of the health problems reported by survivors include high blood pressure, chronic pain, cancer, gastrointestinal problems, diabetes, and heart and lung disease. Some survivors are also at risk for stunted brain development. According to researchers at the BetterHelp Therapy platform, regions of the brain, including the amygdala and hippocampus, can be negatively affected by all types of abuse. These parts of the brain process emotions, and the hippocampus is critical for retaining information. According to the National Institute of Justice, children who are neglected or abused are more likely to develop antisocial behaviors or may associate with others who have antisocial tendencies. This study also concluded that males are more likely to display bullying and aggression, while females tend to struggle with high levels of anxiety or be socially withdrawn. Experiencing any type of child abuse or neglect as a young child is also a risk factor for developing different types of psychiatric disorders as adults, including depression, anxiety, PTSD, eating disorders, and behavioral disorders. Research has also found that childhood trauma and the effects on the brain leave these children more vulnerable to developing psychiatric issues. While experiencing child abuse and neglect increases your chances of struggling with these issues, no study has found that all adults are destined to deal with any type of psychiatric condition lifelong. The disruption of brain development can impact executive function skills such as memory, self-awareness, planning, and problem-solving. These issues often result in learning disabilities, poor grades, and a higher chance of dropping out of school. Many studies have been conducted on the correlation between surviving childhood abuse and developing attention deficit hyperactivity disorder, ADHD. According to the National Child Traumatic Stress Network, researchers disagree on whether ADHD is associated with childhood abuse and neglect. Some pediatric studies conclude that youth with ADHD are more likely than those without ADHD to develop child traumatic stress. Other studies indicate that children who are abused are at higher risk of developing ADHD. Young children who are abused or neglected may exhibit symptoms of hyperactivity and disruptive behavior that resembles ADHD disorder. Children who are living in abusive environments often appear to be agitated, nervous, and on high alert. These behaviors can be mistaken for symptoms of ADHD. Some children who are unable to focus or pay attention may display symptoms of dissociation versus attention problems. During the last 27 years, I have counseled clients who have reported all the aforementioned long-term effects of childhood abuse. I have met clients who suffer from chronic pain, severe depression, colitis, heart problems, addiction.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.